Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Post-COVID Mental Health on Corporate Workspace. My name is Tanushree Majumdar and it gives me immense pleasure to host this impeccable webinar for all of you today. First of all, please allow me to welcome our participants, members of participants, guests, and Calcutta Innovation Parks aims to recognize, reward, and support a large number of early stage social entrepreneurs working with the innovative solutions in India, which is in line with the vision of Tata Group to support socio-economic development in India. One of the key objectives of IIM Calcutta and IIM Calcutta Innovation Park is to help unleash entrepreneurial energy for India's development. The prevalence of anxiety and depression has increased, some countries even doubled. Periods when the highest rate of mental distress were reported correlated with periods of intensified COVID-19 deaths and strict confinement measures. Also, the prevalence of common psychiatric disorders and suicides are expected during the post-pandemic time. Enhancing access to mental health services have been increased, and implementing long-term measures to mitigate the impact of economic recession on mental health and addressing the stigma during the pandemic and paramounts in the addressing areas of the problems. The timing could not have been worse. If falling economy, unemployment, reducing spending, the pandemic and subsequent lockdowns have made a devastating impact on the mental health of the community as a whole. Now, when the timings are coming back from the new normal to the normal situations, we would like to understand your thoughts on how we can support mental health issues long-term. We invite you to discuss and share your thoughts on our Thinking Social webinar, Post-COVID Mental Health on Corporate Workspace. So I'm so happy to welcome our speakers and the speaker for the day today. We have with us Dr. J.R. Ram. He's a renowned psychiatrist with a special interest on children and young people with troubled minds to enable them and find freedom and blossom and relive their dreams and aspirations. And hence he co-founded Mental Health Foundation. The foundation focuses on providing treatment for mental health problems and training and capacity building for organizations working on the interface of education and social care. Dr. Ram has done his schooling from Kolkata, Bangalore, and United Kingdoms. Though Dr. Ram wanted to be a travel chef, but the Almighty wanted him to take medicine as his career and work on the humanity. Welcome, Dr. Ram.
Thank you. Thank you.
We have Shovik Das. Thank you, sir. We have Shovik Das. Shovik is a CEO and a co-founder of Manastik. Manastik provides teleneurology services to dementia patients and caregivers using artificial intelligence. Their focus spans around primary and supplementary services for dementia patients, not limited to dementia screening and tracking, creation of a one-stop solution, recording patient history, caregiving lifestyles, in games, and many more. Welcome, Shovik. Rashida Lajan, she's a co-founder at All Is Well. Hi. She's a co-founder at All Is Well. It is a startup incubated at IIM Bangalore. It is one of the top 100 women-led startups from the Women Startup Program 3.0. They help corporate employees improve performance and enhance mindfulness by dealing with their stress, anxiety, and adversity through their tough design and structured mental lifestyle and mental well-being of the initiative. It has been taken so that it is helpful for them. All Is Well offers well-being programs that equip employees with self-help techniques, aiding to build resilience and keep their enthusiasm in the organization. So, welcome, Harshita.
Thank you so much.
And lastly, thank you. And lastly, to moderate the session, thank you, Harshita. And lastly, to moderate the session, luckily we have with us today Professor Chandradeep Mitra, whom we lovingly call as C.D. Mitra. C.D. wears many hats, but we will mention the most promising ones here. He is a well-known professor and a marketing and innovation, certified leadership and transition coach, advisor and a mentor for MNCs, family businesses, startups, and social enterprises, corporate master trainer and a branding and innovation consultant. He is a founder and CEO of People Magic and co-founder Meta Foresight Advisor and a mentor of IIM Calcutta Innovation Park. So welcome, CD, and all over to you. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. I feel very fortunate and blessed to be part of this panel. I'm the odd one out because I have absolutely no role except to maybe facilitate part of the discussion. I also need to, at the very beginning, apologize both to the panelists and the other participants. Unfortunately, I got roped in at the last moment for reasons that we will not get into. But I have a class at 2 o'clock, which means that I will have to exit about 10 or 15 minutes before. And I'm going to hand it back over to Tanushree so that the adda, the discussion can continue among the panelists. And Tanushree can facilitate that. And if there are questions by that time coming in from audience, I hope Tanushree will be able to curate them and put it in front of the, or, you know, I will also throw some questions. But I'm really, really, because more than anything else, I would have really loved to be part, you know, part of this discussion till the very end. But I have a class and I can't get out of it. Yeah. So I'm sorry about that. But I'm still looking forward to what we're going to do over the next 40, 45 minutes, at least when I'm there. And beyond that, which I'll definitely see the recording of later. So firstly, thank all of you for being here. And I know each of you have different areas of your own skills, expertise. For example, and I'm fortunate I've known or interacted with at least a couple of you before. So what I'm going to ask each of you to do in about 3 to 5 minutes is to, of course, your basic introductions being given by Tanushree, and we don't need to go through that. But if you can kind of zone in on what's happened in the last 2, 2.5 years, and your, that, you know, your perspective about how you know, COVID is impacting not lives in general in terms of physical health or, you know, economic well-being or whatever, but the mental health. In fact, this is something that I was thinking from very early on, that what would be the long-term impact? I mean, the short-term impact, in fact, it's more than short-term impact. Now we hear of something called long COVID, which is a physical symptom that people carry for a long time. But I suspect, and I think you people will be able to say much better, that the long-term impacts are much more going to be on the emotional well-being, more and beyond the physical part of it. So we'll start with you, Dr. Ram. I know you work a lot with young people, adolescents, but I'm sure there's a lot of interaction with what's happening with, let's say, parents and their careers, because the focus of this discussion is about the impact of well-being and mental health in the workspace. And of course, it spills over to your personal life, your family life, and all of that, social lives. So what have you been observing, and what have you been doing? And as individuals, as communities, as organizations, what is the way forward? So over to you. I know it's a very complicated thing.
I would like
you to hear the first few things, and we'll take it to the other people.
Yeah. Firstly, thank you for inviting me to be here. It's a privilege to share my thoughts. You know, Sidi, as you said, I think all of us know that COVID was something which left no families untouched. Absolutely no families untouched in a variety of ways. And one of the, you know, the major things which I realized, you know, while during that phase and even now, is that the economic hardship has taken a huge toll. You know, mental health is uniquely something which has got very, very large social determinants. So all illnesses have social determinants, but if you think of mental health in kind of in a slightly separate category, possibly mental health has got a very, very large amount of social determinants. So therefore, you really cannot divorce what is happening in the community, in the planet, and kind of work in an isolated manner. I think we will go ahead with the discussion and a lot of thoughts would come. If you ask me to summarize my own experience over last 2 to 2.5 years, I will try and just give you 2 bullet points. You know, one thing which I have realized is that all of us have in some way or the other acknowledged that we are all interconnected. We are all interdependent. So we really cannot live in silos in kind of 34th floor of, you know, Juhu in a very, very plush condominium and expect that I will not be affected. I think what comes to our plate every day has got a chain of people who are holding our hands and providing that food. So I think that sense in some way has trickled down to everyone, whether we may acknowledge it or we may not acknowledge it, but we have understood that we are all in this together. So in a way, it has had some positive impact. It has had some negative impact. The other, in my own experience, while because we are talking about workspace, you know, in my limited experience, a lot of you are far more experienced in, you know, the macroeconomic policies. I have realized that a lot of the small scale industries, you know, which operate within, say, 30 lakh per annum to, say, 5 crore or 7 crore per annum, they have been hit so badly over the pandemic that the entire families and the entire kind of system around them are reeling. So economic hardship is such a reality, you know. And few days ago, I had a lesson, really, and I will end with that and allow the conversation to progress. So there is someone whom I see who is 47 years old. He has recurrent depression, and he often used to stop his medicines and have a relapse. And this time also, you know, let's call him Shondeep. Shondeep came, and he lives in Arambagh, and again he has stopped his medicine and has had a very, very severe relapse of depression. In fact, he was suicidal. And, you know, I got very angry and I said, Shondeep, I have been seeing you for about last 13 years and this is the nth time I have told you not to stop the medicines. And, you know, he kind of had tears in his eyes and he told me, Dr. Ram, I'm saying in Bengali, I will translate it for Rakshita. I don't know whether you understand a bit of Bengali, but what he said that, ami ki bolbo, Dr. Ram, ami amar mer school e tuition fees dite pacchi na, ami nije oshudh ki kore khai. So what he said that I can't pay my daughter's tuition fees. So how can I buy medicines which you have prescribed? And, you know, I was put in my place, you know, and I really felt so bad that without knowing what is happening in someone else's lives, we assume so much. And I actually had nothing to say. It left me with a degree of sadness, which I think has happened to all of us. We are kind of imbued by this sense of dejection, and it has had an impact on mental health. But to be honest, it also has shown enormous resilience in people. And I think the way we have come out of this, or we are trying, is through communities coming together and helping beyond their means.
Thank you, Dr. Ram. I'm sure there's a lot more that you can say and add to that, and hopefully we'll come back to this. Harshita, I'm going to zone in on you now because, Dr. Ram talked about, the bullet points. We are all interconnected. It's both a challenge and an opportunity to, you know, hold on and show resilience. But the resilience happens at an individual, at a family, at a community, and at an organization level. And I think your organization's been working with looking at the mental health outcomes within organizations, working with them. So COVID's been the biggest disruptor that, you know, any one of us has ever seen in our lives. So what's been your experience and how have you helped individuals and organizations deal with this? So love to hear your perspectives.
Thank you so much, Siri. I so agree with each word Dr. Ram said. I mean, we all have actually experienced the same, maybe economic hardships, emotional hardships, personal hardships. We were confined at places for a time, not meeting people. And I think the list can just go on if you want to just put down the list of hardships we faced. But let's not talk about all of that. What I really would like to highlight here is through my experience during the last 2 years working with corporate, on the whole, there was a lot of grief. There was a lot of stress, anxiety, and depression. Overall, that was the impact of all of that we just spoke about, the hardships that all of us were facing. And this was a challenge. The bigger challenge was that people were not ready to speak about it, and yet it continues. Not just within the organization, letting their management know that they need help, or their immediate managers, or just peers around them, but also for organizations to actually accept and agree that this help is required at this point in time. This has emerged now during maybe the last 1 year, and it is evolving, and I'm sure it will evolve even better. But yes, that I saw as the biggest challenge in me being into the field and trying to support the mental well-being of employees. Definitely one of the biggest challenges was also this for me, to help them understand that help is always there. We just have to ask for it. It was maybe within the organization or outside. And if I talk of the second part of the question that you had, Siri, how have we actually gone ahead and helped or supported the mental well-being and the emotional well-being of these employees? So we at All Is Well, we work from a prevention space where we provide training programs that can help the corporate employees in a long run. Now, when I say long run, I can probably compare it to the simple example of a vaccination and a medicine, right? So medicines do work. We know this definitely. But what happens here is medicines work immediately, but we are dependent on something external. Vaccination helps us produce or develop antidotes that can help ourselves, and we can actually cope up with whatever is coming ahead. So that's something that we have done, equipped these employees with self-help techniques that they can use at any point in time where they are facing an issue. And there was another part of the question, Siri, that you had asked earlier, and I would like to also probably just put in my two cents there, which your question was, what is the way forward? How do we really look at it? I know the discussion will lead towards it. But one of the main points that, I would like to highlight here is it's all about our mindset. We already have accepted that, yes, this is happening, which was, if we look at the stages of stress also, the first stage is always denial. We denied that this is happening. We denied that COVID is happening. I remember we had, there was a marriage that we had to attend in the second week of March, and we were planning about, this is 2020, and we were planning about the same in February 2020. And, one of my family members said, we really go for the marriage, attend the marriage. And most of our family members were like, why not? This is just happening in China. It's not here. So I think a lot of other things that happened through the course of time, there was denial, but now gradually acceptance is there. So we are accepting a lot of things. So we need to just accept things the way they're happening, work on it, and things will go smooth with a positive mindset.
Okay, so I'm going to come back to both of you in a while. Shobhik, I'm going to lead on to you. But before that, And this is something that ties back to both what Dr. Ram and Harshita, you said. What I'm hearing both of you say is that, and Harshita particularly, that, because this was like such an outlier event, like a black swan event, we went not only not prepared, but we were not even willing to accept. So it starts with acceptance. Now, different people may have different stages of acceptance, or some people may need to get sensitized, right? Shobhik, for example, you work with neurological disorders. Now, be it dementia, be it whatever. What's the degree of acceptance, sensitization, awareness? And are we lacking there? Is that the first step? And the next question is, after accepting, do we know what to do with it? Because sometimes, sometimes well-meaning people end up doing the wrong things because we don't know. We're not really equipped to do the right thing. And do we have the infrastructural capabilities as individuals, organizations, as society, whatever, to know what to do when we know? First is to, accept our own vulnerabilities or vulnerabilities of people around us, be open to sharing and talking, which I think as a society, we've all been conditioned to kind of not make ourselves vulnerable or accept that, yes, I have a problem, or maybe somebody else has a problem. The second is, if I know somebody has a problem, what am I supposed to do with it? Is that the right thing to do? So, Shobhik, I'd like you to talk about this, and I would throw this back to both of you also, Harshita and Dr. Ram. But Shobhik also talked particularly from the neurological perspective. I know you work with dementia and other things. So what's been the neurological impact, and how does has that got aggravated, for example, during COVID? And how has your organization been dealing with that? Over to you, Shobhik.
Yeah, absolutely. Firstly, thank you for inviting me. It's a big pleasure to be here. So on that front, as you said correctly about acceptance, I believe the key term over here is perspective. So we are not used to dealing with a certain kind of perspective. For example, you know, and I believe perspective is connected to certainty. So for example, you know, when we go home daily, we expect a certain people to be with us and we expect them to be well. We expect certain people, you know, to kind of be with us emotionally. When this certainty is hampered, we don't know if that is going to happen or not going forward because of whatever reason, because of them not being there at home, them being in a different city, not being able to come here, or them not being at all in any way. So when this certainty is hampered, then our perspective gradually starts changing about life. And that perspective, I believe, is something, you know, that affects our acceptance. So specifically in neurology, when we talk about dementia, for example, when someone is not able to, you know, talk properly or do some of the daily activities properly, then initially we feel that, okay, probably this man is or this person is, you know, doing it maybe not on purpose, but for some reason. Then gradually when that things happens over a period of time, then we feel bad. And after, towards the end of feeling bad, we start accepting that thing. I think that is important to accept that even this is possible. And one way I believe to go about that acceptance is the fact is, you know, is first knowing the lack of knowledge actually leads to lack of acceptance. We don't know what happens. We don't need to know the entire functions, all the functions of the brain in detail, but we need to know to some extent how the neurological system of our body works. When we know that, then probably we might have a better chance of accepting that, okay, this is the disease or this is a problem that can happen that so-and-so person close to us is suffering from. Firstly, I would like to talk about mental health in general. So mental health, you know, is something that is tied to emotional connectivity. So we are always connected to the people, you know, we feel close to us emotionally. And when we feel that bond is somehow weakened or that bond is getting affected, we start experiencing mental difficulties. I believe that's one important reason. And so when it comes to the neurological area, the neurological community, what happened is it has affected like anything. So for example, the community already, there is no cure for these kinds of diseases. So on top of that, what happened with these people is that there was an increased amount of stress, there was an increased amount of depression, anxiety, and other similar symptoms, which led to people, you know, being absolutely confused about everything. Firstly, the biggest problem in this community is people used to not visit a neurologist. They still don't do. And during and after COVID, this thing has reduced even to a greater extent. Thankfully, it is coming up now, a bit better. So when these kinds of things happen, the entire community is affected like anything. Although thankfully there are some awareness campaigns and lots of other, you know, organizations and non-profit organizations who are trying to, you know, kind of bridge the gap and get more people connected together on a platform to get them educated, I would say, in a way. But even with that, I think on a high level, the problem that has happened is people have started moving away from all these. So there are certain ways which we are also trying to provide as an organizational level, how they can connect with the doctors remotely, you know, and the entire doctor community. So on that front, that is what I would like to highlight upon. That overall people have kind of moved a step back instead of and it will take some time to, you know, kind of people get them on board as to what needs to be done so that they can all be on the same level and then move forward.
Okay, thank you for that. So you're saying that, you know, there is again this whole issue of acceptance and in a way COVID has pushed us back. So I'm now tying this together, and I'm going to come back to you, Dr. Ram. I think you're the best person to answer this. You know, as a society in India, correct me if I'm wrong, I think the level of societal willingness to accept, talk about, or deal with mental health has also been unfortunately lacking. You know, if I have a physical problem, I have no problem telling the world that, you know, I have a cancer or have whatever, diabetes, and I'm going to meet a doctor. But in most of our family systems or society, it's very difficult for one to accept or the family to accept that maybe the child has ADHD or the parent has dementia, whatever. And we hold on and we kind of try to deny it for as long as possible, which of course leads to worse outcomes. And then on top of that, now we have COVID. And one of the problems, what I think is COVID is something that, you know, we like predictability in our life. And COVID was every day, life was changing. You know, there's no SOP, there's no standard way of, even the best professionals were probably trying to figure out what to do. And in that situation, as individuals, firstly, we are not willing to accept we have a problem. Secondly, we don't give respect to mental health professionals, which all of you are. We are willing to go to medical professionals, but not mental health professionals as easily as often. I mean, in the West, if you say, I'm going and meeting a therapist, no one will, you know, look at you in any wrong way. But here there is still stigma, there is still, you know, all of that. So already we had that problem. And now with COVID, it's obviously got worse. So what's the really the way? I mean, is COVID from that point of view an opportunity to actually push back and saying, open up, come on, let's finally accept and admit that we do have problems. And now COVID is a bigger example. Let's just be honest about it and let's start talking.
No, I agree with you, CD. I think if there is one blessing of COVID, that is, it has made us more aware about our mental health. You know, if we can pick one blessing. I'll give you a slightly long-winded answer. Cut me off if I'm rambling on. You know, basically, stigma comes from lack of knowledge, or lack of knowledge comes from a lack of perspective about the reality. So as Shobhik said, so therefore, so suppose what is Harshita doing in the community and what she said is doing a preventive work. She's trying to spread awareness about a condition, about mental health, amongst different sections, which are maybe slightly tight-lipped and, you know, functioning has to go on. And often looking into mental health can be adverse for that company. So if I know that CD is a bit depressed, do I give him kind of some time off rather than knowing that, you know, CD has some heart condition for which he has to go and see a doctor. So often how much credence we give to mental health often depends on our knowledge and perspective. Which I think people working in the community, the likes of Shobhik and Harshita, are doing a great deal to illuminate about that. Now, coming back to your point, whether it is less accepted in our country, I think again, this less acceptance comes from lack of knowledge. Although having said that, having worked in, you know, in a different country for about 11 years, I think stigma of mental health is everywhere. And it is only in Woody Allen films you will see when he is saying that I'm going to a therapist, Diane Keaton is kind of welcoming that. But otherwise, it's a very, very East Manhattan, I feel. I don't think mental health is kind of, you know, that way not stigmatized anywhere. Again, looking into the reason, see, earlier, all diseases were thought of to be curse of God, historically, in 15th century, 16th century. Then as science advanced and we realized that there are bacterial diseases, there are microbial diseases, and suppose syphilis, in a way, was a watershed landmark, discovery of syphilis, discovery of the cholera, bacteria were landmarks. Earlier, suppose if I got syphilis, CD, as a preacher would say, Jairanjan Ram is a miserable git and he is a womanizer and he's a bad person. So therefore, the curse of God has hit him and therefore he has got syphilis. So as knowledge advanced and it percolated down to the community, stigma about mental health reduced. In our country, if you CD, you are a Bengali, you would possibly know about Sharatchandra, you would see that earlier people would write that Poshchime chole gelo, jokha hoyechilo, tuberculosis hoyechilo, and they went to a sanatorium because they were marginalized outside the community. Now we know that you can live in the same house under the same roof if someone has got tuberculosis. Why? Knowledge has come now. With respect to mental health, we don't know anything about the brain. You know, so it is shrouded in darkness. What happens? Are there chemical imbalances? Are kind of there are social determinants? So this lack of awareness, lack of complete scientific grasp over a subject which is quite perplexing, I think perpetuates the stigma. And once we know, HIV in recent times is a classic example that with knowledge, the stigma has already gone. You know, now you wouldn't bat an eyelid to find out that your colleague has HIV and they will live lifelong. So I think it is very important that what Shobhik, what Harshita, they are doing in the community, teaching in all forms, you know, IIM, and you are building the future trainers, the future leaders of India. So I think you have got a lot of, what would I say, raw material, positive things to work with. So one day I will be richer and people come to me with lot less stigma. And maybe a Lamborghini at some stage. So
good. That'll definitely do well for your financial health, hopefully your mental health too. Harshita, how are you seeing organizations deal with this awareness, stigma? And is it true that some organizations are more progressive, some are not? Is it true that within an organization, even if the, let's say the HR head or the CEO, progressive, but down the line, individual line managers may not be that cooperative. Do you see any of that happening? And how does it play out? How does the entire organization become more sensitive, more caring, more supportive?
Absolutely, CD. That is the case. I mean, again, if I go back to the point I was mentioning, the mindset of different organizations and who we are speaking to at that point in time really matters a lot. There are some organizations who are really willing to take this forward, invest time and money. I have had, you know, I'll just, without obviously naming, but I will just give you an example. There was this organization I was pitching to, letting them know about our services and explaining how it really helps. So what I told them is, you know, this is really going to help because they would be out of their stress. One of the points they mentioned was, if I really have to, you know, work on the stress of the employee, why should I not just have, you know, a stand-up comedy and that's done? So again, you know, I mean, and I pay lesser because, you know, you are going to have sessions which will last longer and they enjoy that day at least. For your session, they have to be attentive. They have to be with you. They have to learn. They have to take back things. So, you know, it's a lot about the mindset and specifically of the people we are interacting with. So, you know, I've had times where I've gone to an organization, explained about the services we offer, what we do, how it benefits, but it has not worked. But at a different point in time, got an opportunity to speak to someone else. So it's also about individual perspectives within the organization and who personally I get in touch with and, you know, call it an opportunity or not, how it really works. And the same is the case, you know, within the organization as well. Some of them are really willing to help. And, you know, in one of the organizations I was helping, the manager. So, you know, the structure that we were working in, the managers. So the workshops were organized for a lot of employees. The managers had to report. I mean, they were directly in touch with me, letting me understand what exactly were the challenges these employees were facing. So again, here we had, you know, people with the way they looked at things very, very differently. Some of them would actually were very, very empathetic and would actually, you know, feel that this is really needed. Others would say, you know, it's just a drama. It's just acting. They really are not facing as much. Even all of us have faced, you know, the same thing. COVID is not just for them. It's for us as well. So I think it's more about the individual rather than it's about the organization, who you're interacting with. You know, it's like it said, people never leave organizations, they leave their bosses. So I think, you know, that also fits in here because it's all about the individual and how it is. And I think that is the area we're trying to work in, bring in that change in perspective, help people understand. And as Dr. Ram was mentioning, let them know and give the knowledge which is required, whatever we've learned out of our experiences, to help them be more empathetic and be a part holistically of the system.
Okay. I saw Dr. Ram raising his finger. Maybe he wants to say something.
Yeah. You know, I entirely agree with Harshita. You know, I just kind of, because I have a lot less hair and done this for a while, can I just share a couple of my
thoughts? Yeah, do. But on the hair bit, I compete with.
You know, what I have found is people with personal, if the senior management, if any of them have personal experiences with mental illness, they themselves or they know a family member, then they are far more receptive. So often when we have gone into a very hostile territory, we kind of don't begin with, so we say, let's talk about who you know with mental illness. And if you don't know with someone with mental illness, then do you know someone with disability, neurodevelopmental disorders and stuff? And then kind of pitching it from personalizing it for them and kind of portraying the real lives of the lived experience of people who go through the distress often kind of works for some people. I agree, it may not work. The other thing is, which we often try to do, particularly with parents who are very reluctant to acknowledge that their children could be depressed or having some psychological issues. We, you know, in a very Machiavellian way, put it in that the school performance will improve if you kind of, you know, work on this, you know, and Bengalis are, if they are not anything about, they kind of study, and tuitions are, academic achievement is the biggest thing for them. Bengal has the highest number of private tutors in India, which is actually a genuine piece of information. So often we tell parents that, okay, we see that, we realize that this parent is not very psychologically receptive. So we say that the school performance will improve if you kind of go through these treatments. So often I think we have to, you know, adapt and mold so that people can agree. But I think senior management having experience of mental health issues, I think, is the clincher.
Okay, so I'm connecting the dots with what, and I'll come to Hoshobik now with what Harshita and you, Dr. Ram, said. One is, you know, where does empathy come from? And very often what Harshita says that, you know, everybody's facing COVID. I dealt with it, so why can't you, right? But not everybody's the same. And the fact that, you know, our emotional resilience may not be the same, and that doesn't make us better or worse. For that, unless you've had either personal experience or know somebody who's had, that understanding or empathy or sensitization is what's lacking. That's what I heard Dr. Ram say. So, Shobhik,
can I just...
You
know, CD, I feel lack of empathy is nothing but lack of imagination.
Okay, good. That's a good point.
To expand the imaginary capabilities of the person you are working with in senior management, in your students, just expand the imaginary capabilities with real life stories, and they will be empathic.
Okay. So I'm kind of connecting all of this to the fact that, you know, as societies, as organizations, to some extent, even as individuals, have we been, I mean, I'm connecting back with what you said, Dr. Ram, which is about performance in school. Have we all also become very performance driven, so much so that, you know, very often it's easy or convenient to brush mental health issues under the carpet because these are slow burn issues. These are very qualitative, touchy-feely issues. And we are driven with hard facts and numbers. There's a lot of alpha male leadership in the world, be it organizations, be it countries, where, you know, you're always driven, push yourself harder and do more and you can't afford to, you know, break down or accept vulnerability. Is that a larger societal and organizational narrative is also which is corrupting this process, which unfortunately doesn't allow us to, you know, look at the more human aspects and the individually different aspects that each of us are going through, our lived experiences? I would like all of you to respond, but let's start with Shobhik because he's not been part of the conversation for a while.
Yeah, so I really like the question in the sense that, you know, absolutely, on an organizational level, there are certain goals, there are certain targets, deadlines that are to be met on a very regular basis. And there are tools, some of the best project management tools out there, which are used to track whether or not they are met. Now, when we've got the analytics and the data of all this, it is quite easy, you know, on a mechanic level to understand, I mean, who is doing as per what the expectations are. And the expectations have reached, I mean, they have reached in general, they are such high that, you know, it's sometimes, as you said correctly, sometimes we forget that there's a human aspect to it as well. For example, you know, if someone has to deliver a project, someone has to deliver something within a week, but then his father is suffering from COVID, then what can be done? So these are some kinds of situations. So in this case, in many companies, usually what they do in the first thing is they usually fire them and get someone else, which is the bad reality that happened. And also I would like to add an interesting point, which I was about to bring a while back. So the total aggregated global loss has been around $1 trillion which has impacted the mental health, you know, during and post COVID. So if we try to track it, trace it back, what we see is what could be the amount of impact that those humans suffered, which could have led to this kind of financial loss and this kind of financial footfall. So one thing which we can, I think, know is that on a managerial level, as Dr. Ram and Harshita said correctly, on a managerial level, this needs to happen. I mean, if the bosses, if the immediate boss of the person who is suffering is willing to help in any way or just support does not mean talking. Even if they give some time off, that's the bare minimum one can do. Even that can help. So one thing which I believe is, you know, is talking out loud is to not do anything more, which I can understand. For example, if the manager is also because you have to think from the manager's perspective also, right? Managers also have to fulfill a deadline. It's not that they can only cater to the engineer or the person below them and they can leave everything aside. They have to fulfill some deadline, or if the manager can be fired. So from manager's perspective or from anyone from the senior executive, what can be done is just by talking out loud, is by being more verbal, is by spending time talking to everyone impacted. That's the bare minimum they can do. Even if they cannot give out time, since there are deadlines to meet, they can talk to the people who are in need, help them understand the situation, to create the perspective, which we also as an organization try to do, is we try to create the perspective amongst the people that this is the situation, to help them better understand what's going on, so that probably there's a better chance of them accepting and there's a better chance of them dealing with the situation in a better way.
Okay, so I'm going to pick this up, which is what you said is, you know, opening up, talking. Harshita, I have a question for you. You know, during COVID, I mean, the good thing was we had technology. We had things like Zoom, and we suddenly realized there's so much you can do actually with technology that we otherwise wouldn't have. But did it also take away some of that human and the personal touch? For example, when you have Zoom meetings, it's very functional. You don't have the opportunity for those, you know, coffee chats that you have with your bosses, with your colleagues, where you get to know each other, where you connect at a personal level. Everything is very routine and functional. And now that a lot of people are saying, maybe this is the way of life, work from home, work from anywhere. Do you think that, you know, human bonding, close connections, empathy, is that something that could be, because we are talking of a lot of organizations continuing this way of work, is going to be a challenge that will be a legacy of COVID? What do you think?
Definitely, CD. I mean, these all of these actually are the core of our mental well-being, you know, the bonding that we need, the empathy. Sometimes it's also the touch that might just help. And all of this online we know is missing, has been missing. Going forward, I think what really would help is there are a lot of organizations who are still working in hybrid mode. And some of them are totally, they've decided to be online, at least for a few years from now. What I think would really help here is trying to create that bonding through different ways. Now, these ways can be, you know, like having, you know, meetings which or outings that, you know, are done at regular intervals, or sometimes it's just an event where all of us can just meet. Or it can also be like, you know, when one of the organizations I was working, we tried doing this and it did not really help because, you know, there were certain issues that they were facing. We tried to have outings, we tried to have dinner parties. This, all of this really did not help. The people wanted to meet. The people wanted to be together. And one of the feedback that we got, which was really very powerful, was, you know, I want to, one of them said, and this was through Google Forms. So one of them said, I just want to sit with someone and share what is going around me. That's it. And which probably was missing in this. So what we actually did for them is, again, this was done though hybrid, you know, for some of them, it was done online because they were spread across Pan India. But some of them met and we actually created, you know, meeting rooms where people who they did not know, two people met and they shared their ideas and the problems, the challenges with each other. It's important to remember that people are not necessarily looking for an advice whenever or searching for advice, you know, when they're sharing their problems. Sometimes all they need is a listening ear. So this I really, you know, thought work, and you know, some, this is something that can be practiced later as well. And you know, as Shobhik was also mentioning, this has to come from the managerial level. They have to open up. They sometimes have to be vulnerable, speaking about their own challenges. And then, if this passes, I think to a certain extent, it can be worked on. Because you know, if we look at the decision of these organizations who decided to be online, totally going offline, it might not work for them for various reasons, but you know, working on certain small aspects can really bring these big changes.
Okay, so I'm going to take that cue and go to Dr. Ram, and this is going to be my last question. I'm going to exit, but I'm going to request Anushree to carry the conversation. And I think you guys are going to be very well equipped to talk to each other and maybe ask each other questions. I'm going to look at the recording. I'm sorry, I'm going to exit after another 2-3 minutes after Dr. Ram answers the question. So Dr. Ram, one of the things you talked about was your own lived experience that leads to, you know, you're expanding your imagination, therefore empathy or whatever. One of the things that Harshita talked about is that, you know, when leaders themselves are willing to talk and share, you know, lead by example, not in other ways, but also lead by example of talking of their own vulnerabilities, of their own issues and, you know, how they cope or how they try, but maybe not always succeed. You think that helps set the culture? You think that's something that organizations should do? Because unfortunately, traditionally, leaders are supposed to be, you know, this really strong people who are not vulnerable. And that's why we look up to them. We put them on a pedestal. But do today's and tomorrow's leader in the COVID and post-COVID, do they need to be more human? And would that help?
You know, I'm possibly the... I shouldn't be kind of talking to you about creating leaders and stuff. You know a lot more about it. You know, I have considered, you know, in my own very, very limited experience of working with teams, I have seen, you know, the attribute of generosity of spirit, if the leader has, actually pays you back multiple times. And it might be, as Harshita said, you know, it's a... just listening, kind of saying that, okay, you know, take 15 minutes off. And it might be a water cooler moment of sharing wisdom that, okay, as, you know, see, human beings are exclusively social animals, you know, so this a generous conversation around a water cooler with your boss, you will be surprised how much people remember it after 20 years. You know, I have had experiences where I have thought that I have said something very innocuous to an adolescent And they have come back to me 15 years later and said that you told this to me. You speak to teachers and you know you teach, and you will be surprised how what people take seriously and put it in their hearts. So I think, you know, generosity of spirit, if it is in the top management, it trickles down. And then you create a team where you are no longer required. You know, I feel that the hallmark of best leaders is to make yourself redundant. So I now work in a team with 20 people where, to be honest, I am redundant. You know, people tell me that, but it's more out of sentimental value. I know that I might not be there even, and they will, you know, function possibly more effectively. So I think, having said that, there is also a cultural perspective which we need to be kind of conscious of, that how much vulnerability do I need to kind of expose? So I think being gentle, acknowledging that, yes, we have had dark moments, we have had periods of uncertainty, and it is normal to grapple through uncertainty, feel lost, but yet find our way back, is often very reassuring. Because if CD is kind of listless and is very vulnerable, then I, as a junior, I think, my God, he is this IIM boss, he's a professor, so he is not, then what would I? So I think you need to anchor them that we all struggle through, muddle through, it's a stumble, but we'll find our way. So I think conversations which are sensitive, respectful, I think that is another point which I want to mention. I think being respectful to whatever your experiences are, I may not be able to, you know, have the same experience. You know, we work a lot with LGBTQ population, and the trials and tribulations they go through is unimaginable for me. You know, I, as a cisgender person, it's impossible for me to imagine. But I think respectfully learning from them. So I think those attributes have to be there in a leader. Having said that, they have to kind of ultimately lead the way. Okay. They have to lead the way.
So I've got a very interesting. So I heard words like generosity and gentleness and kindness, sensitivity. Setting a culture where beyond a point, you're no longer, once the culture is set, you're not the always need to be the go-to person. Being a little, letting people know that it's okay to face problems, not know the answer immediately and struggle, but also kind of give a sense of hope rather than saying that, you know, even I'm hopeless, so it's okay for you to be hopeless. But leading on saying that it's a phase, but, you know, one can struggle, but get through. And here are my experiences when I struggle, but here is how I get through. And maybe you find your own way. So leading on, a good leader is not only show a certain degree of vulnerability, but also shows a light to a brighter future. And that balance is the important hallmark. And when you finally set a culture where others imbibe it and pass it on within the company. So that's a very good learning. I would love to have this conversation. So those of you I know, so it's on me, Dr. Ram, next time we meet, a coffee or a drink, same with you, Shobhik, same with you, Harshita. I would love to have more conversations, and I'm going to watch this video. Please, my deepest apologies, I got to withdraw now, but I'm going to let Tanushree take this over, and you guys have a lovely conversation.
Thank you.
So
thank
sorry
you,
to leave. Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you, CB. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much, CD. Thanks a lot. To everybody, if I'm sitting here today and listening to you all and, you know, speaking to everybody, I'm grateful to three most important people in my life. One is my mom and dad, of course, Almighty, as well as Dr. Ram. I still remember it was in the year 2015 when I went up to his clinic and, you know, I don't know, I had a periods of recurrent emotional problems, and I was just sitting at my home and I was just thinking, I was just asking everybody around me, is there a problem in me? Why is it I'm feeling so low? It's not that, you know, I'm not doing something or the other and it's not working out. So most of my relatives, my colleagues, friends, everybody said, just don't bother so much about it. Just go and have a drink or go out and, you know, have a time out. Do these things and everything will be fine. I literally did that for 10 days. But then again, what I did, I went up, you know, I was thinking that maybe I require a medical help. I can't take somebody along with me because I was just thinking that the stigma is always there. You know, you are going to meet a psychiatrist. That means something has gone wrong. So today I take this pride and privilege to tell you all that, yes, I have been there. I've been there. And the first question Dr. Ram was asking me was, Tanushi, did you come alone? I said, yes, yes, I did come alone. And there wasn't a single word that I could utter. The only thing which I was doing was crying. So I don't know what was that, but yes, it took some time and around three and a half years. But yes, now I can sit in front of you and listen to this. So Dr. Ram, one question from my colleague, and it is, I think it's something which is very prevalent in these days because it is very hard for everybody to accept this, first of all, and then to make ourselves vulnerable to others to decide that, yes, if this is the thing, then we can't take it forward, right? So one of my colleagues has written that when you are suffering from mental health issues, is it advisable to let your employees know or hide it so that you don't make yourself vulnerable? And there is another one question. Do people are born with this anxiety or depression, or if that is triggered from the reason, triggered from the external environment, and how do we avoid this in the long run? So if you can just answer this question.
Yeah. Thank you, Dhanushree. Thank you for being so generous. You know, it's a pleasure seeing you after a few months and years. I think the first question, possibly Harshita would be better qualified than me in answering. But anyway, I will put in my two pennies of thoughts. It's a hit and miss, really. And what I advise is not to actively hide and kind of say that I'm going through a problem, because often, again, I have been surprised by the support staff have received when we thought that they wouldn't. But again, it can backfire. So I think it is important, if you trust your immediate supervisor, if you trust your trusted, you know, colleagues, maybe sharing some of the problems you are going through and seeing how they, whether they are receptive to it, and then taking it forward. Because remember, as Shobhik said, that the senior managers are also under pressure. They also have to deliver. So I think it is a hit and miss situation. But on the whole, I prefer disclosure. I prefer disclosure, but it can, you know, play out in many, many ways. Regarding the second question, everything in this planet has got a genetic contribution, but it doesn't mean that if my mother was depressed, I again would be depressed, because it's a lot of, as I said right at the beginning, there are many, many, many social determinants of mental health. So therefore, environment plays a very, very large role, and genes, of course, are there in the background. But if genes are there, it doesn't mean that you will invariably have the illness, or if you do not have the genes, it doesn't also mean that you will not suffer from anxiety, depression. So the short answer is there is a genetic contribution, but it is not inevitable.
Got it, sir. Harshita, would you like to add on to it?
Yeah, Dhanushree. So the first part of the question, what Dr. Ram mentioned, was absolutely bang on, that, you know, we need to speak about the problems or issues that we have. But it's equally important, as he was also highlighting, to see who are we speaking to. And at the time when we are facing a challenge or an issue, sometimes we are not in a mental state to be able to decide whether particular person we are looking at for help, for support, would be the right one or not. So here is something that I always tell people, that you know, it's very important for us to work on our support system. With the current times that we are facing, we really do not know what is in store for us tomorrow. I may be very healthy today, mentally I'm talking about. I may be very mentally healthy today, but what comes tomorrow, I am prepared for it. I would accept it, but I really do not know what is in store. And so do all of us. We really do not know what lies ahead of us. So it's very important that much beforehand, we recognize, we know to ourselves that, okay, just in case there is an issue, there is a problem, this is a person I can or I should contact. And your network really plays a very, very important role. Have such people in your network that you know you can rely on. Maybe they cannot help you directly. Maybe, you know, again, it's not about giving advice, as I mentioned earlier. It's never about advice. It's about guiding you in the right direction. And even, you know, when people go to psychologists or, you know, for therapy, most of them, as it was being mentioned earlier, that it's not that people who are mad are going there. It's just about a third person perspective. And sometimes the third person perspective can come from a lot of people already existing in your network. So one, recognize these people, and second, build a rapport with them so that, you know, tomorrow, if there is a need, maybe for you or your family members, you know who you can get in touch with.
Thank you so much. Also, Souvik, I just wanted to know, since you're in, so just wanted to know, how would you recognize if somebody is going through initial phase? That's what is very, also, is there any physical health impacted after the mental health issue? Is that a factor which can make out?
Yeah, absolutely. So to begin with the question, you know, to add on to what Harshita said. So for example, you know, if someone suffers a problem in their hand or any other body part, we don't feel ashamed. We go to the doctor. So similarly, if mental health is something that happens with the brain or the nervous system, so when that happens, if there is a need to go to any kind of specialist doctor, we shouldn't be ashamed at all. We should accept that just the way we accept any other disorder or disease. So brain, just like other organs, is just another organ, just that it is the most sophisticated organ. That's why we feel that, okay, it is something that controls us, or something, you know, that is kind of very close to us. That is something we can say, what are we? We are the brain, something like that we can say. That's why we might feel ashamed. But on that front, what is the question again? If you repeat, sorry.
Yes. Is there any physical symptoms that we can understand prior hand so that we can part of this?
Yeah, absolutely. So it all begins, you know, with when it comes to physical symptoms, it all begins with the people usually not being themselves. Meaning, for example, the very first, I would say, usually symptom that usually occurs is either anxiety or depression. And the secondary thing that usually occurs along with that is probably the memory loss. And that occurs in episodic format. It doesn't occur consistently over periods of time. It occurs in places we might not even think of or expect. That's why brain is the most sophisticated and complex organ, we can say. Because we cannot predict. For example, even if someone is undergoing, you know, anxiety or depression, we cannot predict where and how the person will be suffering and what exactly will be going from. For example, even let's say if he or she, you know, is tending towards forgetfulness, we cannot say that, okay, now that the person is suffering from forgetfulness, he will forget this. But that person might forget something else where we might not expect that. So that is one thing. And yeah, so to answer your question, definitely on a physical level, symptoms are seen. But initially, usually depression, stress, and anxiety is what it starts with. Always, all the mental health disorders and confusion.
I think I just wanted to add that, you know, this is now what we know in 2022, over last about 15, 20 years, that it is erroneous to think of mental and physical as separate. And Actually, it is, you know, there was a guy called in 17th century, I think in 16th century, called René Descartes, who actually made this mind and body split. But ultimately, so this philosophy that mind is something very separate from your body, we now know it is no longer true, because brain is the central organ which coordinates the entire functioning of our heart, kidney, everything. So therefore, if something goes wrong in the you know, in the brain wiring or the brain circuitry or the brain chemical balance, it affects the way we feel. You know, one of the best interviews, and I really, really admire that person, is Deepika Padukone, because she came out with the fact that she was suffering from depression at a time when it was, you know, it was many few years ago. And for her to come out in the public and say that I was depressed, I think is really, really remarkable. What, if you read her blogs, there she says that there have been days when I couldn't get up from the bed and it felt like I have been covered by a concrete blanket. So it was a very, very physical thing that she doesn't describe about her sadness, which she goes on to, but she describes a physical sense of discomfort and lethargy. So again, it is happening because, you know, because of depression. So depression doesn't just affect the mind. It affects our immunity. It affects our cardiac functioning. It affects everything. That is why stress, which is a psychological phenomena, affects our entire system. You know, we know that if we go through a period of stress, our cancer can worsen. We know if we are going through a period of stress, our immunity decreases. So it is, you know, everything is interconnected.
Anushree, can I just add something?
Yeah. Yes, please. So, yes.
Yeah, we were talking about, you know, because, you know, emotions really manifest both physically and psychologically. Probably, yes, we know of the symptoms that, you know, are seen physically and psychologically. And then again, they have a effect on our actions and our behavior. That definitely is the framework and the structure it works in. But one point I really wanted to highlight when we were talking about, with the example that, you know, when Dr. Ram spoke about Deepika Padukone and said about the physical manifestations of what we are feeling. You know what, our physiology is a very important part of our mental well-being, and we can actually use it as a hack to work on our mental well-being. I'll tell you how. We all know that the reverse is true, right? When we are feeling psychologically low, it affects our, you know, body as well. So if we are not feeling good, we would probably be lethargic, just want to sit at one place, not talk to people. And so all that is there. But the reverse is also true. And we can actually use that to our advantage. Now, just a small demonstration, if I can. If I am really feeling very happy, but I put my hand in my chin like this, and I frown and I say, you know what, I feel so happy. Can I feel happy? Or if I am, you know, really sad and I say, you know what, I'm so sad today. Can I feel sad? We cannot. So our, you know, how we are, you know, aware of our body is, it's very important. Being aware of our physical manifestations of the different issues and challenges that we face is very, very important. Because once we know that, and we know the link between these physical manifestations and the psychological manifestations, we can actually control that. And, you know, that is why it is said that, you know, if you're feeling low, just start laughing. Why do you think it works? It works in the reverse manner, but it does work. And you can try this next time. You know, you might sound, or you might look like a not a very sensible person. I don't want to use the word idiot, but yes. But that is how it may look and sound, but it ultimately does work. So, you know, physiology can really be taken at our advantage to feel the way we want to feel.
Actually, Harshita is taking on from there. Yeah. You know, a lot of therapists, actually, when someone is overwhelmed with a lot of these emotions, negative emotions, they start working on their physical well-being and, you know, a sense of physical control. So if you are feeling kind of, you know, knots in your tummy, do these things. And it actually then trickles down overall to a sense of larger well-being. So in fact, a lot of therapists do this work.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, right in the beginning, it's not just understanding what the, you know, the patient is trying to say, or the person is trying to say, and what lies in his mind. It's also the therapist would also observe their physiology and see whether they're in sync, because sometimes not all of them are ready to really disclose or speak about what lies within. So, you know, the sync there can be seen through the body language, the physiology. So yes, absolutely agree with that, Dr. Ram.
Yes. Also, Dr. Ram, I just wanted to say that there are a few questions that have been posted in the chat box.
So seven is a lot, depends on the upbringing, as we heard generally from 0 to 7 years, because most of the time is passed. Right. It's question number 7 is one, or
yes.
Being emotionally unstable, is it a mental disorder? My wife would certainly label me as an emotion. You know, I'm very, very emotionally unstable at times. So, no, I think being emotionally unstable, you know, I think we have to, coming back to that question, emotionally unstable, I think we have to look at the context, really. No one becomes emotionally unstable just because they wish to do so. I think it would be improper for us to label someone as mentally unstable or psychologically ill without having to look at the context. And I think we see a lot of, particularly, you know, this is particularly happens with women. If you are going through problems, if you are reacting to the adversities which you are facing, and then if you speak out, then I would say Harshita is a hysterical woman. She is emotionally unstable. I will not look into what are the contexts in which she is being pressurized to react like that. Why am I being emotionally unstable? I think that is the crux of the whole thing. So I disagree with that question, that I think emotionally unstable doesn't necessarily mean. We all are emotionally unstable at many times. If my pet dies, if I have a bereavement, would you then tell me that I'm psychologically unwell? I don't know whether others want to pitch in, but
I do agree. I mean, there was this time, you know, when we would speak about this and often compare that if we were absolutely emotionally stable, we would not have been humans anymore. You know, it's feeling the feelings of others which makes us more human, and sometimes we are touched by it, so emotionally as well. So all of us, I mean, I'm sure all of us here, Shobhik and Dr. Ram, would agree that, you know, we have our own times when we do not feel good, and it's okay. As we spoke about in the beginning, it's okay not to be okay. And we work on it, but it's totally fine.
And also
fine.
I think emotional stability is overrated, because, you know, at times we go into depths of kind of joy.
I just wanted to know one more thing.
Go ahead, sir. If everyone is very emotionally stable, boring, and, you know, there wouldn't be creativity, there would be great pieces of art, music, literature, sharing of emotion, world would be a terribly boring place. It is these, what we call as emotionally unstable people, who provide color to our lives, and, you know, so and they can be often very creative, generous. So, and also we have to look into the context why some person is feeling like that.
So Harshita just wanted to know, is there any small quick questions? We are running short of time, so just wanted a managerial level, or maybe the leaders up there would implement small things that we can do so that we can look after the, you know, mental health of our employees, and we can take out the best out of them, and they can do their work properly. And we understand and empathize those people more, rather than only, you know, just thinking about how they react or how they are behaving, or why is the person doing these things if they are doing as such. So Harshita, if you can just give us small things on those
things. Yeah, sure. So quickly, Tanushree, I mean, this is related to the question that you've just posted. If I get to the question directly, what can corporate implement? I mean, you know, it's a very big question to ask someone, because, you know, what works for one organization might not just work for another organization at all. This is also because of, you know, a lot of not just cultural differences that they would have, but also the way they function, the geographies, and a lot of other factors. So just saying point blank that this is what the organization should do to ensure that the mental well-being of employees is taken care of would be unfair on my part, you know, to have just a few pointers written. But yes, what we can definitely speak about is at the individual level. At individual level, I will just probably summarize the points that, you know, we've already spoken about. One very important factor is empathy. We have to be empathetic. Next time, you know, somebody is telling you a problem, just stop. Don't be judgmental. Just pause and reflect. If people can do this at all level, I think the culture within the organization itself can change, if it is to be changed and if it is not really empathetic. Just listening to people, not being judgmental, stopping, pausing, and then reflecting, and then coming back with a response would really, really help. But this is a huge thing to implement. But at individual level, we definitely can do it. So, you know, yes, one, empathy, and the second one, mindset, which goes along with this, is really required at the individual level.
Wonderful. And just wanted to know, I think I posted two more questions. I think Harshita and Shobhik would love to answer this. Shobhik, I think if in case mental health is taken care of, how does COVID affect the employees and the management? That already has been answered. I just wanted to know, is it possible to make social mental health care economically viable? How can you make that survey?
I'm sorry, can we hear Shobhik? I'm sorry, Shobhik.
Shobhik, can you hear me? Am I audible?
You are audible, Tanushree.
Harshita, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, Tanushree. Shobhik, I was not able to hear him.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I think some
internet. Sure, we have lost.
Yeah.
So, Harshita, would you love to answer?
I think Shobhik, you can go ahead.
I'll try to speak. Hopefully, I'm audible. So,
yes, you're audible, Shobhik. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So until now, you know, everything that we knew we had to do, we had to pay something or to give something to get something back. But this is a question, you know, in which we are kind of in a way thinking loud before doing that. So to make economically viable, you know, as I said, one thing, the first important thing is to create the perspective in people as to what needs to be done. And when that perspective is needed, we can't make it economically viable directly. But what we can do is we can reduce the need for them, you know, to need these kinds of mental health services, as they say. We cannot eliminate it completely. That so-and-so person has to use it. I'm speaking directly. At least we can reduce the amount of care, health, or services that person might need over a period of time. That is through creating a perspective and awareness.
Yeah, that's wonderful. So, Dr. Ram, just wanted to know if you have some last signing off remarks.
No, I think, as I said, the pandemic has made us much more aware about mental health issues. So that can be one of the very few blessings of the pandemic. I think the fact that we are having this conversation directing towards large companies, I think, again, is a change in the direction. Unfortunately, you know, I hate to end with a discordant note, but I think it is still very much a multinational company phenomena. I would like to see more Indian companies embracing the concept of mental health and taking it seriously. And even at a very, very smaller levels, organizations which are not very big, unorganized sector, and even at homes, really, there has to be a percolation that we need to maybe acknowledge that the person can be having psychological issues and be respectful towards them. And then the rest eventually will follow.
Yes, sir. Perfect. Just one more question. Always a stigma for them to come to a doctor. So how do you support, like, should that be done? One should think that
Can you say that again? I couldn't. Can you type your question? Hello?
Yeah, sorry for the inconvenience. Yeah. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah. Now you're audible.
Did my question reach out to you, sir?
No, I didn't hear you properly. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, just wanted to know that in your aspect, what is important? Like, a person should directly go to a counselor. Is that is advisable? Or initially, how the person will understand that the person requires to go to a counselor first or to a doctor and attain medications? So that division ideally.
Yeah, written. I think majority of people don't try and need medicines right at the beginning. And I think we often work in an environment where counselors are quite sensitive to refer patient on to psychiatrists if they need it. So I think my first approach will be go to counselor. And if you feel that things are not working out, ask your trusted family physician and then go to psychiatrists. Definitely, I think there can be a lot of things which can be done before you come to a psychiatrist. And remember, for a country of 1.3 billion, there's only 8,000 of us. So I think it is best to approach other people and then definitely come to us if you have any doubts.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone. What an incredible session it was. I'm sure everyone out there have been boosted enough and geared up to explore the idea and move ahead with it. Thank you so much to all the speakers for actively participating in the webinar. Dr. Ram, thank you so much the inner core of my heart, Harshita, for explaining things so clearly and taking us to the journey of mental health and entrepreneurship as well. I would like to thank CD as well, but he is not here. So as usual, thank you so much, CD. And I would like to end the session by one of Bob Proctor saying, if you can see it in your mind, you can hold it in your hand. Thank you, everyone. Please stay safe. And may you and your family be blessed. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, Sanushi. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Sanushi. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Take care.
Bye.